What is up, everybody? It's Matt Johnson. We are back with another episode of Real Estate Uncensored. This is the place where you get actionable ideas, insight, and inspiration to turn your real estate career into a life of freedom and become the rock star agent in your market. And we've got a really killer episode today. We've got two great guests, one of which will be with us for the entire show, one of which, sadly, I will have to kick off about 15 minutes into the show. And we all know who that is, but we'll get to him in a second. But first, we've got a lot of stuff to get into. We're going to be talking about how to ask the tough questions, the hard questions, the thought-provoking questions, both in your real estate business and with your clients. And so we're going to talk with our special guest about that. And in the meantime, I will introduce my illustrious colleague, the junior grandmaster himself. He's in the co-pilot seat, Greg McDaniel. Greg, what's up today?
I'm fucking ruling life, dude, is how my day is going. It's unbelievably awesome. You know, and I just drop F-bombs right in the very beginning because I know that irritates the living shit out of Matt. So I do it just to see him look away. You know, I can see him on the sideshow going, why doesn't McDaniel do that? And I do it to get the nose pitch, Johnson, and I'm glad to do it for you. No, but today's going to be awesome, dude. My chick and I, we're heading out of town. We're going to head up to Bodega Bay area in Petaluma for the weekend. It's going to be awesome. You know, just get some R&R. Maybe go watch some super bikes race around and people get turned into human beef jerky if they fall. Hope they don't, but they just might. So I'm living the dream, dude. I'm living the dream. And we got guests coming out of our ears today. You know, I met our special guest at a 4th of July party. We just became buds. You know, her boyfriend was hosting the event. We had a great time. We had an individual that drank way too much booze. And the ladies there were helping clean her up. It was quite a disaster, but a lot of fun. And she's a hell of a coach. So welcome. Aoli, right? God, I always fuck that up so bad.
Oh, that was terrible.
I know. I said it was bad.
It's like somebody tied your verbal shoelaces together and you just fell flat on your face.
Oh, man.
All right. Well, then I'm done embarrassing myself. We'll move forward.
Here we go, Greg. Aoli, welcome.
Oh, you got it.
You fucking show off.
Oh, I know. It's terrible. Well, first of all, welcome, and give us give the audience, especially since the people on our end of things in the real estate community probably don't know who you are, but you've got a very deep background in other areas, and we'll get to that in a second. But just give everybody kind of a 60-second bio on who you are, where you are, and what you do.
Sure. So my name's Aoli, often known as Coach Aoli. If you look for me online, that's how you'll find me. And I'm an executive coach, and I work with a lot of leaders and executives and anyone that really wants to be more effective at leadership, and particularly around communication and influence. And I've been doing this work for about 15 years now. So I started my career working with leaders, and still am now. And I'm in San Francisco. I'm based in San Francisco, but my clients are all over the world. All of my coaching is done by video conferencing. So that's a little bit of about me for now.
Awesome. For now. And then we also have our less special guest, Gene Volpe, the Volpinator, because he is here every Friday delivering a social media and or tech tip. Gene, what's up today?
Moot Jackson and Greg Garius McDanielis. It's good to be with you guys today. If we're screwing up names, I'm just going to do it, right?
Might as well fuck it up, man.
I'm going to do it.
A mouthful. All right, so let's start here. I am curious because I was talking this over today with a good friend of mine earlier today. And guys, if you go over to the UX Mastermind Facebook group, the video is posted there from our conversation. Just we're posting all of our behind the scenes book writing sessions as we hash out the material for the UX book. So one of the things we're talking about today is success rituals and the idea that you have to reward yourself both on a daily and weekly basis when you accomplish the victory that you set out to accomplish, right? So let's start with you, Aoli. How do you celebrate success, whether especially the daily success, the stuff where we can't just blow out and take a whole weekend to Petaluma to celebrate our success for the week? What do you do on a daily basis?
On a daily basis, well, at the end of every day, I actually have something called the 5-minute journal. It's a physical journal. You can also, there's a digital version online. And I complete it. And at the end of the day, there are two questions. And it says, what are three amazing things that happened today, and how could you make today better? And I always add in there things that I'm proud of and things that I want to celebrate. And I will do that on my own. And oftentimes I will share that with someone close to me, whether it's my sister, my man, my somebody, because I like to, you know, it just feels better when I get to share it. And usually it involves Bitmojis. If you're not into Bitmojis, I love Bitmojis, and I find that they are so fun to use. So that's how I celebrate both my own successes and my clients. Actually, I have them do it regularly as well.
Nice. Very cool.
That is really good. I'm actually starting to journal myself on a daily basis. And I gotta tell you, it is really fun to write those down on a daily basis. What are your wins? What are you grateful for? What lessons learned that day? It's amazing to do that. I haven't gotten to Bitmoji yet. This is only my fourth day of journaling. I will get to Bitmoji level someday soon. That's level 10 shit right there. That's good stuff. I'm only at level three.
Greg, I can't wait to see you attempt to draw like GIFs from Anchorman, like in your journal.
Oh my God, that would
That's
be awesome.
really that's a whole superhuman level we all attain, we aspire to attain. Gene, how about you? How do you celebrate success, especially on a daily basis?
Bubble baths.
Sounds about right.
Right? Scented, turkey scented bubble baths.
Turkey.
No, I don't know what that. I don't know where that came from. I apologize to everybody listening. No, listen. I don't do enough celebrating. My wife will tell you my life is a celebration, but I don't. I try to get into journaling, and I really, it's one of those things that's very difficult for me. I can't tell you why it is, but I'll typically have a glass of wine and just kind of relive the day in my mind, and I think some of my celebration is, this is going to sound goofy, but is in the prep for the next day. So when it's all winded down for the night and I'm sitting there with my red wine and kind of planning out the next day or two, I kind of feel like that forces me to go back and relive what I did wrong, the previous day, right?
Interesting. Wrong or right?
Well, no, I mean, well, you know what, dude, that's a great question. And I think we did say celebration. For as much as I do like celebrating the wins, I think it's important to be able to look back on. I mean, look, we all have failures every day, right? I fail on a regular basis. And so in order to have a win tomorrow, I got to fix my failure from today, right? So I think the failures are as important. I mean, I certainly don't dwell on them, but I'm aware of them, and I'm constantly trying to fix them.
Interesting. Well, we got. I'm as you guys, as Matt and I and Gene and Aelia, and we're all sitting here talking. I want you guys to type into the text here. What are your wins, so everybody can see what your wins are, so we can all celebrate together. Because we all do it in a little bit different ways. I'm like you, man. I sit back, have a cocktail or two, and I just take some quiet time. And just kind of just like I got to lose those pesky fucking 10 pounds I've been trying. They've been sticking to me like glue since January. Those bastards. And I'm going for like, 1 to 10 mile hikes every single day. And that's kind of how I reward myself, to get some fresh air in my lungs, to get out, to get moving. And I'm seeing the results. And so I like it. So I reward myself on that factor. It's fantastic. Booze and working out, great, great pairing right there. I mean, just in the club.
Well, it's like, what is it? Andy Grove said something about, for every metric you track, you have to track the opposing metric. Greg, that's all you're doing. You're just tracking the opposing thing, right?
One shot, 20 steps. One shot, 20 steps. That means every 40 steps, I can take another shot and I still burn weight off.
Exactly. Exactly.
I really love this topic, and I have to, I think as the coach in the room, have to add to this. I think it was Gene, you were saying that it's helpful to look at what you could do better. I have found time and time and time again that that's what we all naturally do. We all naturally can see what we can do better, what we didn't do enough of in the day, and what we don't do enough of is celebrating. And so I know with my clients, I actually, every single session, and none of them like it when I start. And then after a month or two of doing it, they get used to it. They don't really love it, but they get used to it. And it's doing self-acknowledgement. And I think also because as leaders, we don't get a ton of acknowledgement from other people. And so we have to really do it for ourselves, because if we're waiting for recognition from other people, it's likely not going to come, and it could really be a downward spiral. And so I teach my clients to do self-acknowledgement. I'll say, hey, what do you want to acknowledge yourself for? And it's really awkward at first, especially when you're saying it to somebody else, but it's a really great practice. And we're talking about daily rituals. I encourage you to do that. It's like, yeah, what do I really want to acknowledge myself for? Maybe it's something you do every day that you want to acknowledge yourself for, or maybe it's something you did differently or that was a little hard or out of your comfort zone. And what I really have them do is not just to think about like the task or the action, because that's what we often do. It's like, oh, I wrote in my journal today, or I went for a 10-mile hike. It's like, yeah, but what did that take? Like, what was the character trait or the quality? Like, it took dedication, or it took perseverance, or it took courage. And those are the kinds of things that we really want to remind ourselves that we have. Like, oh, we have these qualities, so we can always just go back and pull on them when we really need them, because we often forget that we're courageous people or you know, devoted or dedicated or hardworking or whatever it is. So those are the qualities that I encourage my clients to highlight for themselves and acknowledge themselves for. So I thought I would throw that in while we're talking about that.
I think it's really amazing. Good. I mean, we all pretty much put ourselves down on a daily basis. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. I couldn't get that happen. That I didn't get the deal done. When in reality, you got to remember your micro wins and that you are, hey, you have a ton of value to bring to both the business, to your life, to your spouse, your partner, your kids, you know, to everyone around you. But we get into the self-deprecation, you know, mindset where it's all negative, it's not positive. And I think you correct me on this one, but I think the fact that we do this because everything in the media is negative. All ads are fear-based. So we get in the mindset of fear and negativity. That's why I do. I stopped watching the Today Show in the morning when I'm getting ready. It's amazing how much happier I am. And they just dumbass conversations anyways, but I mean, it's amazing.
I was going to say, you got to have more than a couple of brain cells to rub together, you know, now that you've stopped watching that. You're going to be like George Costanza, like you just all of a sudden spontaneously get smart. You'll be coming in like you're bringing in like War and Peace, just reading, all of a sudden just be recounting facts, random facts from the World Almanac.
That's probably true. Speaking of cool ass shit, Gene, what do you got for us today, man? What kind of tech, you know, tip are you gonna drop on us?
Wow, that's a little twist. I'm used to that coming from Johnson.
I know you threw me way off.
Yeah, you threw me off. today we're just gonna do this. Is a real quick one, and then I'm gonna get out of Ahalya's way. This is later.com. So it's a scheduling service and software for your Instagram account. Kind of unique, but it allows you to actually set up some, you know, you're going to do your Instagram stuff on a regular basis from here, right? Uh-huh. And you're going to do it real time and live. But this is something that will allow you to create different pieces of marketing information and schedule it out to your Instagram account over the week. It's kind of a neat little tool.
Interesting. So this is Later. Is that what we need to
Later,
look at?
That's what it is, later.com. So yeah, there's a free version of it, which of course we love to use. There's a paid version. It's like, I forget what it is, $9.99 a month. Now, just real quick caveat is that this is something that I want you to incorporate inside and with your other Instagram marketing. You shouldn't do only scheduled posts from Later because there's a lot of things with the algorithms.
Wait, so you don't want Instagram to look like Twitter right now?
Correct. That's exactly right.
Okay, good.
Yeah. And then, by the way, Instagram doesn't want to look like Twitter either, so they'll cut you off.
Yeah. Good. Maybe they'll do a better job of managing their app.
Yes, maybe they will. But I have the link is in there, guys. So if you guys are looking to take a look at it, go in there and take a look at the link. Mm-hmm. Later.com. Pretty interesting looking stuff, I got to tell you. Now, Gene, what have you found to be the best way to use this?
So you're going to laugh. I do this thing called Hip Hop Motivation, which is like a couple times a week. I pull out a quote from some kind of rap song, which is both hilarious. You know, it's both hilarious and when you look at it, there's some good stuff. So
Something? Was it you or Greg that posted something the other day about I didn't have to use my AK, so today was a good day.
No, that wasn't me. Ice Cube, 1993.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to be turning that into a hip hop motivation, though. That's a good thing. Okay. So I schedule those things out over the week once in a while. So I do that. It just makes it easy. I giggle. So you guys are giggling. It gets a lot of engagement.
I'm telling you what, I need to do this. I need to rebut your hip hop motivation with a grunge Dean modification. So every time you post like a hip hop motivator, I'm going to post like a quote from like the lead singer of Alice in Chains that like died of an overdose in 1997.
All right.
We'll put a quote from Alice in Chains or Soundgarden up there.
All right. Challenge accepted.
Right. Oh my God.
And I'll tag you in every single one too.
That's right. All right, good. I like it. So, all right, Gene. So, before Greg interrupts, how do people reach you, Gene?
Yep, this is important, Johnson. Be careful, guys. I want you guys to go check your accounts really quickly because the automated account that Gene's posting up there, make sure that you don't do it too much because Facebook has banned automated systems for their IG accounts. So be careful on how much you use it or it could damage your account. Just red flag, just in case. Don't go all hog wild and, you know, ankle deep in bullshit.
That's good. That's why I said to you, you want to intertwine this with your other stuff. If they see you're active on a regular basis, they will allow a little bit of leeway. But if that's all you're doing and you're hitting it all the time, they're going to flag you for sure.
Yeah, good. Now where they find you, Gene?
GeneVolpe.com. So I told you in the last one, for your crew, I'm giving away 15-minute consult sessions where we will take a look at their digital presence free of charge because they're friends of yours. So just have them, if they go to GeneVolpe.com and fill out the contact form and just let me know they're friends of RU Live, I'll be happy to get on a webinar or call with them and kind of just overlook some of the stuff and give them some tips and pointers.
Good. Cool. And we encourage you to do that. I would like to see all of Gene's free time sucked up by RU viewers calling him for free 15-minute consults.
I'm okay with it. Listen, I'm okay with it. As long as
Gene, you're not going to have a lunch break for like 5 weeks.
That's okay. I'm okay with it. With all the weight I just put on in the last week, I could skip lunch for the next 2 months. I'd be okay.
Well, quit taking. What have I told you? While you're taking your turkey bubble baths, don't drink the water.
It's hard. You know how good it smells?
I know. It's like bathing in Thanksgiving dinner. All right, Gene.
This is true. Holly, good enough to meet you. Have fun with these guys.
Later.
See you guys. Have a good weekend. Later.
Yeah. Oh my God. All right. So Ahalya, you mentioned that for people to find you, I want to make sure that we get a good plug for you too. So where's the best place for people to go to connect with you?
The best place right now is probably LinkedIn. I'm just redoing my website, so that's probably the best place, and they can just look Coach Ahalya up and find me easily.
Perfect. 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 All right, cool. So let's get into it. Let's see. So Hank is watching. We got Paul. We got a bunch of people live. Hank says, thanks for the knowledge while I attached my winch to my bumper. Yes, it was a quick use of the lottery of time. So good. Hank was my guest on the UX podcast earlier today. If anybody knows Hank built a six-figure coaching business essentially in about a year to a year and a half using nothing but Facebook and a phone. So that interview with him is on my Facebook profile. And will soon be coming out as a podcast episode. But let's jump back in, Holly, with you and let's talk about some more of the questions. And so in your coaching work with clients, I'm especially curious, like when you're working with executives, whether it's Silicon Valley or tech startups and things like that, where they have like a real direct influence on the outcome of the business and how quickly the business grows a lot of times is a function of just them as a leader and how well they communicate and how well they recruit and hire. What are some of the very first things that you work with people on when they come into kind of a relationship with you?
Yeah. I'm a big believer in starting with the end in mind. And so I really think that one of the top reasons why people don't get what they want is because they don't know what they want. You know, they're not, or they think they know what they want, but they're not entirely clear on what it is. Or they want something that they heard someone else say they should want, but it's not really what they really want. And so they're not fully sort of aligned with it. And so my first question to anybody, you know, even before I start working with them is, okay, well, hey, if we work together for 6 months, what would you want to get out of that? You know, how would you know that coaching was successful for you? Definitely. And I'll really just keep, you know, drilling, like being a better leader is too vague and too broad, right? So I would say specifically, like, what does that mean for you? Because everyone has things that they're challenged by or opportunities that they see. And so I encourage that for everybody, you know, whether they are in real estate, or whether they're leading a tech startup, or whether they are an executive in a larger corporation, you've got to be really, really clear on what that end is and what it is that you're working towards. And once you can sort of see it, you know, you literally in your mind see it, articulate it to me so clearly that I could create a film about it. Once it's that clear, then I say, okay, well, now where are we today? Then I want to hear like kind of what your challenges are now, you know, where you feel you are today. We'll start with I'll often do sort of a 360 type of interview. So I speak with people that they work with to get a sense feedback from others on what they're doing well and where their opportunities are to develop. And then we'll create sort of the roadmap, the plan of how to get from where they are today, point A to point B, that, you know, their vision. But again, I think that 80% of the work really is around clarity of where they want to be. And clarity is 80% of the work. A good amount of that clarity is the where they want to be. And then some of it is just being honest about where we are now, you know, because sometimes we're not honest with ourselves about what we're really great at. Sometimes we're really blind about what we're really great at, so we don't leverage those strengths. And then sometimes we're blind on kind of what we're not great at. But I find that that's most of the case. That's not, most people know what they're not great at. Most people can tell you right off the bat all the things they're not doing and they should be doing.
Right.
strengths. You know, it's like the strengths, like the things that I'm really great at that I'm probably not leveraging, that they're not clear on, or it's the what they really want and why they want it. So that's like a really important piece, is not just the what you want, but the why is that important to you. And once people can get really connected to the why, you've probably found this in your own businesses, you know, it's like you just all of a sudden have this drive and this motivation and this pull to take actions that you weren't otherwise taking.
Yeah, that's really true. I was having breakfast with a friend of mine, and she was like, she's a boat without a rudder. She has no clue where she wants to go, but she's flooring it, and she's either doing circles or slamming into rocks on a weekly, daily, hourly basis. And that's where a lot of people really are on a consistent basis, and they're frustrated because they have no goal in sight. You have your conscious and your subconscious. Your subconscious is what drives everything in your life, and so you have to tell your conscious mind where you want to take this thing. And, you know, journaling for me, when I sat down last Saturday at my open house, it said there's three goals that you want to achieve in 13 weeks. It took me fucking 8 hours to figure out what I wanted. I thought I was clear. I'm as clear as mud. I mean, it was amazing. And then Matt and I came back together on Monday, and we both had like a brain dump on each other. Like, oh my God, okay, this is what we want to do and blah, blah, blah. You know, to grow the podcast. And it was like, oh my God, like we're totally aligned on it. But we now have a mission and a path to get there. And I think that, you know, if someone was to sit down right now and they were to map that out, where would you have them start? Personally, professionally, you know, spiritually, physically, you know, where should they start, Ahalia?
So people really struggle with this, actually. They oftentimes you'll add and they'll be, I don't know what I want, or, you know, and so I always say, start with what you know for sure. Start with what you know for sure, because there are certain things you know for sure you want, right? Like, I know for sure I want more money in my bank account. I know for sure I want that. Mm-hmm. You know, I might not know how much more. It's like, okay, well, let's not worry about that yet. We know, you know, I know I want that. I know for sure I want to get better at influencing people in this way, or influencing this group of people. I know for sure I want. So that's what I recommend people start, where they start, because it's the easiest place to start. Let's not go into all the things you don't know. I get it. You know, there are lots of things you don't know, but there are certainly things that you know for sure. And that's where I'd recommend people to start. And once they start doing that, then, you know, it can become more clear and more clear. And I talk about this thing called the clarity confidence loop, like picture like sort of an infinity loop. The more clear you get, and you think back in your own life, I know this has been true for me. The more clear you get, the more confident you become. And the more confident you become, the more clear you get about something. And then the more clear you get, and they feed into one another. And so I really highly recommend that, you know, just start with whatever you do know for sure. And then you'll feel a little bit better, a little bit more clear, and then a little bit more confident. And then you might say like, oh, I really want this. I really want that. Because a lot of times people don't say what they want because they don't think they can get there. Mm-hmm. Or they don't think they deserve it. You know, and that's usually on a subconscious level, right? We're not sort of consciously thinking, I don't deserve that. But there's some part of us that thinks that or thinks that we can't get there. And so we don't want to say it. I know I deal with this all the time. It's like, well, I want this, but I don't want to say it because I have no idea how I'd get there. I don't know if I will. And I certainly don't want to fail. And so then we just sort of get in our own way before we even start the journey.
Yeah, you really do, Amy. There's a thing called the Sedona method. It's so simple that it's scary. It's three simple questions, guys. I use it on myself all the time, literally daily, multiple times a day. I use the Sedona method. And so what it is, you first feel the whatever the problem is. So like, I want to make $100,000 just for round numbers. All of a sudden you get that sinking feeling in your chest. You're like, ugh, like a weight on you. And you're like, you think to yourself, I can never do it. Or I don't know how to do it, or whatever else. First you identify and you're okay with that feeling. And here are the three questions. Could I release it? You know, then you ask yourself, would I release it? Then finally, the question is, when? If you answer all three of those, it can be yes or it can be no. It does not matter. Do not vacillate between the two. Just pick one or the other, a definite answer, yes or no. You will release a level of negative energy around that problem. It will be out of your system for good. And you will then open up and allow the free energy flow throughout your system, your mind, your body, your spirit, the whole thing. So that then you will start subconsciously and mentally going forward and towards that goal, because you now believe at a core level that you can achieve it. And that's the one thing that Secret never taught me when I was listening to that kind of stuff. They didn't tell you how to get rid of that little nagging feeling. And, you know, I think when people release that and get over that and are able to move forward from that, then these goals of not knowing if they can actually achieve something completely go away, because it's not about how do I get to this goal. It's just the fact of you owning the fact that you want it.
Yeah.
That's it. Don't try to figure out the minutia. It'll work itself out. Just figure out what your goal is. Mm-hmm. You know, it's insane. Like 3 years ago, I have my goal book that's right here. And I put in here exactly what I wanted in a woman. Right. And I am literally dating her right now. You know, Lily is to a T, about 97%. Not everything's 100%, but about 97%. We joke about that. How do we get that other 3% up there, babe? and, you know, she's 97% of what I wanted in a woman. I wrote it out 3 years ago, and I had no fucking clue how I was going to get there, right? Yeah. And all of a sudden, I'm like, oh, well, here it is. And bada-bing, bada-boom, bada-boom, bada-bing. Ha! Here it is.
Like that. You know, one resource that if people don't know about it, I'd love to share it, is Think and Grow Rich. It's a classic. It's by Napoleon Hill. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. And he talks about, you know, he did a ton of research, and it's a great story. And the first thing he says, you have to have a burning desire for whatever it is you want. Like, you have to know what you want and then have a burning desire for it. And I really do find that that's true, is that so many people say they want something, but they don't really, like, truly, madly, deeply want it, you know? Right. And I've found that anything I've really wanted that badly, I have found a way. Because you're just so focused on it. You're sort of this, like, you have this obsession with it. And when it's just kind of like, oh, yeah, that would be nice to have. Like, oh, it would be nice to have 100K. It's like, nah, probably not going to happen. But when it's something you really, really want, then, you know, your focus is there, your attention is there, you start paying attention to things that are going to attract that, you know, or support you with that. So that burning desire for it, that really wanting it, is an important part of it.
Yeah, guys, if you guys got a pair of balls, you know, or lady balls, it doesn't matter. write out your goals, write out what you really want in the comments right now. Share it out there, make it public, so that, you know, you're not going to be held accountable to, but at least you, like, why the fuck do I mess up your name every single time I say it? Oh, but anyways, Holly, yeah. Hey, I know I'm going to do it the whole time, so we're just going to get used to that.
All good. Aoli for the rest of us.
Aoli, what's up, Aoli? mustard mayonnaise mix is great.
Oh, my God.
No, but you guys, write it in there. I want to hear your goals. I want to hear where you want to go with it, because it's uniquely awesome when you write it down and it becomes real and you can see it. Then you're like, okay, now I can tackle it, because your brain will start working, you know, to find a way to get that dream or that goal. You have to be careful about how you write it. In my goals of 2014 or 13, I wrote down that I wanted to drive a Jeep Grand Cherokee SRT8, right? Now, in my mind, subconsciously, drive meant own. Guess what I did December of 2014? I drove a Jeep Grand Cherokee SRT8 on a video shoot. I'm like, ah, damn it.
Should have been more clear.
I know. And then my business partner bought the damn vehicle that I have on my wall right here. So be careful and make sure that you want to have these.
Well, he's just a bad person. That's all that is.
Motherfucker. No, I love this.
So I love the clarity confidence loop is that that's so spot on. I think people they underestimate just how important that is. And they look at, you know, other people that are really, I would guess, what would you call, like, implementing at a tactical level? Like, they're really just, they're consistent. They're out there. They're on social media. You can see that they're implementing in their business. You can see them lead generating. You can see them succeeding. And other people look at that from the outside in and go, I don't understand why I'm not like that. And when you really dig into it, you start to find out, like you said, they don't really know what they want, or they're chasing artificial goals that were set for them by someone that says, I see you could do X. And they go, you know, I agree. I could do that. Let's make that a goal. And so I always get a kick out of coaching conversations that go like this. I want to do, you know, I want to double my business. Well, why double your business? Let's quadruple it. You need to quadruple those goals. And they're like, wait a minute, why don't we step back and ask them why they want to double their business in the first place? Because let's make sure that that's even the right goal, let alone then 10Xing their goals. Because the thing is that there's the flip side of the whole, like, the 10X thing, right? Phenomenal book. But people miss, like, half of it, right? Which is, you can't just set 10x goals. You have to set the right 10x goals that make you want to take 10x action. Because if you don't take 10x action, you're not going to get goals, no matter how good they sound, no matter how much backslapping you get on Facebook for posting them. So I always, it's just one of those things that's amusing to me. So how do you drill down and obviously you're doing this kind of work one-on-one with clients, but I want to show people, give some insight into how they can kind of take themselves to this process. How do you really drill down kind of into your own goals and figure out, is that really a goal? Like, does it really hit that emotional need that I'm trying to fulfill? Or am I just like accepting goals that other people are kind of artificially putting out there because they just see potential in me?
Yeah. Yeah, I encourage people to go through the sort of the why process. And so it's sort of, you know, it's like, okay, well, you know, if I say this is what I want, or this is my goal, it's like, okay, well, why is that a goal? And then answer that again, and then answer that again, and answer that again, and just kind of keep digging deeper into what's really important about that goal. If you can't even answer the first level question of why, it's like, oh, I want to 2x my business. Why? Well, I don't know. It sounds like a good idea. It's like, okay, let's move on to something else. But if it's like why and they can answer it, it's like, okay, well, why? Because, you know, I want more money. Okay, well, why do you want more money? Because I want to travel more. Well, why do you want to travel more? Because I want – and it's like you just keep digging deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And if you can do that, if you can do that for multiple levels, then you're really starting to get at something that's really true for that person. And once they get really connected to that, you know, and what that is usually something very broad. It's something like, I want to feel free. I want to be happy. Yeah. I want to be fulfilled.
It's always a feeling.
Exactly. Right. I want to like, or it's like something like, I want to serve. Like it's usually things like that, like much broader sort of human nature type things. Once they can get really connected to that, but they can connect that, like, I want to 2x my business to like this deeper human need, then it starts to become real and visceral. And they start to have this, you know, feeling in their body around it. And that's when you know that, okay, like this is a, and that's something, and then we forget about it 5 minutes later. So that's the other thing, is the constant reminder of it, right? That's why vision boards are helpful, or reviewing your goals every morning are helpful, or however you want to do that. I mean, I know I have my own coach, and when I coach my clients, it's like, we'll review it every session so that we keep it top of mind.
Really is. I, with my goals that I have down in my book here that I'm reading, I made a promise to myself, I'm going to review them morning, noon, and evening time. We've had a couple of guests come on our show that review their goals on the hour. They had an alarm go off every hour on the hour at the top of it. He would quickly go and he'd review his goals. Guys, the time frame from achieving them to setting them to achieving them came to almost zero, because his subconscious and conscious were aligned and he knew exactly where he was going. He didn't deviate. He didn't get lost. He didn't review it one time and, you know, like, oh, it feels so good, I did it one time. Well, your subconscious doesn't know that that's really where you want to be. That's why what you guys can't see is this huge wall covered literally from floor to ceiling with images and quotes and things that are my dream board, which is more of a dream wall than I have mine on Pinterest. Go create it today. I mean, the chances that the universe is like their own personal Amazon. They can order whatever they want from it, but they have to be consistent about it, right? And you have to be steadfast on why you want it. I liked what you were talking about. So don't worry about why you want it. Just say that you want it and it will come to you. But you have to be consistent and persistent at looking at that and having a positive feeling for the outcome. Because if you tell yourself, it's not going to happen, I want it. It ain't ever going to show up in your life.
Yeah, ever. the belief part of it is, you know, like I said, the desire part of it's really like that you really, really want it and clear on why you want it. And then the belief part is equally important. It's like that's possible, that it's going to happen, and the acting as if it's going to happen, right? And the being showing up as if you're already that person that's making that amount of money, or that, you know, that really important piece of it too. And that's hard. That's not, you know, it's way easier to say than it is to actually do or implement. So that piece is important.
Yeah, I had an interesting experience this morning, Greg. I'll fill in some of the details behind the scenes for you later. But the gist of it is that I experienced something yesterday that I automatically interpreted as a setback. And so I was talking with my friend about it, and he said, all right, well, give me the data. So I said, well, this is what happened yesterday. He said, all right, well, how did that compare to what's the past date? I'm like, well, I don't really know. I'm comparing that to something that I wasn't really tracked the first time around. So I had a certain expectation and it didn't meet that expectation. He's like, yeah, but what was the expectation based on? What data was there to base that expectation on? I'm like, I made up a number out of thin air. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe maybe the process of setting that expectation was not so good. And he's like, there's your problem. He's like, so is, and he's a big data guy, and which I totally get, that that's his passion. But yeah, it's one of those things where you realize that if you're not tracking things, especially if it's something that happens consistently in your business, if you're not tracking it, you get this, we have this idea that we can magically have like this fingertip feel for our business and for how things go are going to go and should go. And then when they don't turn out the way that we want them to, we interpret that as a bad thing, even though our expectations were set essentially like I did. Like I plucked a number out of thin air and said, well, this is what I expect to happen. And then when it doesn't meet that, I think it's a failure. It wasn't necessarily a failure. It was a failure at right at the beginning, which was that I set an expectation based on nothing where I didn't have direct control over that outcome. It was just something that would happen as a result of my actions. And then I essentially set myself up for failure by creating this weird expectation that I had emotional attachment to. It's one of the weird things that we do, but especially for agents, guys, that really drove the point home that if you're not tracking like the number of conversations that you're having, mm-hmm. all the way down to the number of deals that you're doing, it's very tough for you to it's very tough to set expectations. It's very tough to set goals, and it's very tough to set the right goals where you're taking the right actions that's going to produce the right result, because you have no idea what inputs produce the outputs that you want. And that's where most agents and most small business owners live. We do input and we expect output, and never the twain shall meet, right? They're not related in any way. So I had that like driven home with a hammer this morning by a friend of mine.
Thank God someone did that to you.
I know.
You know, that's funny, because that's actually the thing I really took out of that conversation, is that sometimes we can't do it alone. And I think that a lot of times people try. And yeah. mm-hmm. and I'm a coach, and I have my own coach. You know, it's a best practice for coaches to have coaches. You guys can probably support one another. You know, you have your own support system. It doesn't matter sort of how successful you are or how accomplished you are or where you are in your career and, you know, your professional life. It's important to have that support system, that person. I certainly have a girlfriend of mine who's also really, you know, a really successful business owner. And she knows I'm the person to reach out to when I need to remind her exactly what the person reminded you of, Matt, which is, hey, what are the facts here? What are the facts? Because mm-hmm. she's like spiraling. She's like, I feel like a failure right now. Can you just ask me? And then I say, okay, what are the facts? Like, I just know. And then we talk about it. And she's like, okay, I feel better now. I'm like, great. And like, that's all I needed to do. And she even knew what to do. She just couldn't do it on her own, you know? Yeah. And so I really encourage people not to try. Like, you don't have to do it on your own. I know that for me, I struggle with this sometimes too, where I feel like I should know better. I'm a coach. I help other people with this. I've read a million different personal development books. I could write this stuff, but it's hard to do it on our own. And so I really encourage anyone that's, you know, listening and watching here today to really just get your support system out there. Even whether it's mm-hmm. one person or a whole team of people. I need a whole team of people. Like, one person is not enough for me. So I need my sister on call. I need my coach. Man. I need my girlfriends. I need, you know, so, yeah. and I have different people to support me with different things. Like, I have somebody that supports me, you know, specifically around my finances. I have somebody else that supports me just like cheerleading type of stuff. Like, you can do it. And so I, you know, I really encourage people to have that and leverage that and ask for help and not feel, you know, bad that they need it and all of that. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, Holly, I mean, that brings up a good point. We all do need that support system in our lives, but I would strongly recommend that it's not your spouse.
Yeah.
As the person.
Point. Yeah.
I mean, you need to have that separation of church and state. Because when you come home to, you know, your husband, wife, significant other, boyfriend, girlfriend, what dog, cat, goldfish, whatever the fuck it is you come home to, you know, you want to make sure that the business can stay business, personal can stay personal, so you don't overlap them unless you really want them to, which I highly recommend you don't do. But, I mean, find someone that you do trust, because a lot of the stuff you're going to talk about, Holly, you verify this, but a lot of stuff you're going to talk about is going to be pretty interpersonal. There's going to be some shit that you're not going to want to tell the average Joe that's walking down the street. So someone you have a trust level with, like Matt and I have a very deep trust level. I mean, he and I talk about like everything under the sun to each other. And that's why our partnership on this, you know, podcast and the business that we're building is so strong, because we trust each other without a doubt. I mean, if he goes, dude, jump off the bridge, take 10 grand, you'll land just fine. I'll be like, fuck, all right, I'll jump off the bridge and I'll take 10 grand with me. Because I know he wouldn't.
Can I tell you to give me 10 grand, then go jump off a bridge? Are
you
for
that? You can, and I probably won't listen to you, but yes.
Okay, all right. So the trust has its limits. I got you. You just don't trust me. That's fine. I'm going to go cry after the show.
In the dark with your bottle of scotch.
That's a great point, both about spouses, as with anybody else, actually, you know, because not any friend is going to be able to support you with, you know, in the way that you need to be supported, or in whatever area it is that you're looking for support. So certainly building that support system, and who those people are, who those mentors are, or who that who that support system is, thinking through who those people are is an important part of that.
Oh yeah. I was talking to Hank Avink, the guy that was commenting on our Facebook live earlier. Hank is a phenomenal coach. One of the things I like the most about him is that he is extremely, extremely intentional on who he allows into what he considers his inner circle. So for example, we have such a relationship that I essentially just said, hey, do you want to jump on this podcast with me and talk about how you built your coaching business? He shot me back a Facebook message within like 60 seconds and went, just name the place and time and shoot me a link. Didn't ask any detail. Like, he showed up to the podcast. He's like, what's this for again? And which is funny, but also an indicative of the level of trust, which is awesome. But I think most people, they're not that intentional. We all have those people in our life that we trust to that degree, but we're not intentional about who we allow that level of trust to develop with. And so we end up having people that are kind of a mishmash of successful, where we want to go. Then there's people that are they're pulling us off track. There's people that are on our level, and we kind of allow this mishmash of people into our inner circle, rather than being very, very strategic. And that's one of the things that I'm trying to get better at, is getting very intentional about who I allow into my inner circle, along with guys like Greg.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's true. I was talking with Lily the other day, and she gets advice from all these different agents out there, right? All like how to do this crazy business called real estate. And I said, babe, you've got to stop listening to everybody. It's like an asshole. Everybody's got an opinion. Okay. You know what? You've got to understand who you're listening to, why they're qualified to give you the advice. And don't, you know, if there's an average producer that's giving you, oh, I would never do door knocking or cold calls, or I'd never do this, it doesn't work. It's like, dude, no, you don't work. That's what doesn't work. And so, you know, how do you filter that though? You know, what are the qualifications you should look for, and the things that you should run from when it comes to taking advice from people?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's an interesting thing, because as a coach, I actually give less advice and do a lot more listening. So I'll often say to my clients, hey, it's true. 100% of the time, I can never do the jobs my clients are doing. Mm. Like 100% of the time, you know, I'm working with senior executives, founders of startups and companies that are scaling. I've never scaled a company. I've never exited. I've never run a massive corporation. I can't do that work. So, and they're not hiring me for that. You know, what they're hiring me for is how to be more effective at influence, how to be a better communicator, how to build better relationships, how to motivate their teams and you know, make sure that people are engaged and productive, and how to achieve their goals. All of those things. Those are the kinds of things that I've been living and breathing for, you know, since I was 15, probably even before I started my career. So I encourage you, it's like to say, well, what is it that I actually want support on? Mm-hmm. And is the person that I'm receiving the support from, are they skilled, or are they knowledgeable, or are they successful in that particular area, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, I might go to one person to ask them about my finances. I would never talk to them about my relationship, right? Like, that's not their zone of genius. And so being clear about that, I might go to someone else and have them, because they're a great listener, so that I can vent, but I'm never going to ask them for advice, right? That's just like, that's not their thing. And so like, that might be where, you know, a spouse might come into play, right? It's like, hey, like, you can just sort of ask them for, they're there for you, you know, they'll listen, give you a hug, that type of stuff. Mm-hmm. But don't get business advice for them. I learned that the hard way with my dad, actually. My dad, you know, God bless him, of course he wants the best for me, and of course he's trying to help, right? So I can see that all he wants to do is contribute. And he'll give me business advice. And when I first started out, I would take it because my dad's an important sort of figure in my life, you know, just somebody that's taught me a lot. And so it's natural for me to sort of listen or care about what he has to say or what he thinks. And then I stopped and I thought, my dad has no business, like zero business bone gene in his body. Like, ever. That. Why am I listening to what my dad has to say about that, you know?
Oh my God, that's funny.
So it's really, really important. Oh. It's like, okay, I'm going to have my dad. How I leverage my dad now, you know, because he's like this. Him and my mom have been like this since I was as early as I can remember. They are my big cheerleaders, right? Just like my sister, my brother. So when I have an important meeting, I will tell my parents about it. I'll tell my mom to pray for me because that's her thing. You know, I'll tell my dad to like send me good vibes or think about me at 10 a.m. when I'm meeting with so-and-so. And they'll be thrilled to do that. I wouldn't ask them, hey, like, how do you think I should approach that conversation? Like, that's not what I'm going to do with my parents, right? And so that's really, it's like really being conscious and thinking through how am I going to leverage the support of different people? And when it comes to advice, like when you're actually, you know, might execute on something that somebody tells you, then you really want to ask yourself, is this person qualified? Is this the right person that I need to be listening to? And I would base that off of track record and results, really. That's it.
Yeah, 100%. It's like you never trust a bald barber or a skinny chef. So, I mean, you want to make sure that I love how you qualify those people. And I found myself doing that. There's a lot of people that I'll be sitting there, I'll be talking to them. I'll sit there, what the fuck am I taking your advice for? You suck at this aspect in life. Oh, I got to go. But I don't, subconscious, I'm like, I just want to talk to someone. So I go talk to so-and-so about blank.
It's so natural to do that, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Yeah, we kind of talk to people because they happen to be in our life that day. They're there. Yeah, they're there at the time when we feel like we need to talk about something. So therefore, I'm going to talk to you about this thing. Like, yeah, it's like, wait a minute. Yeah, I got lucky this morning because I had a 7 a.m. call scheduled with exactly the right person I needed to talk to at that moment. Total accident. Other than that, yeah, it's funny. We need to be much more strategic about who we have in our lives and why and what we talk about them with. And it's funny that you have that experience with your dad, literally the same exact thing. Yeah. And anybody that knows me, cause my dad was a pastor growing up. So like in terms of like character development, best person to talk to. If you want to talk, like if we want to debate theological doctrine, 10 hours, I'd like 10 hours of conversation. I can go down that path with him. When it comes to business advice, not going to take it.
Sorry, Mr. Johnson, if you're listening to that.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry, Dad.
And Gina, apologies.
I want to add another piece because I've definitely had some people say, well, lucky for you, you have, you know, supportive parents, or you have, you know, a coach, or you have this, or you have that. You have access to these people. And I think it was Robin Sharma that I first read this. You know, he writes personal development books and leadership books. And he said, like, go have coffee with Gandhi. And I'm like, what? Gandhi's dead. Like, dude. what he means is go read a quote by Gandhi. You know, go read a book of someone that you admire. Go listen to an audio by Tony Robbins. Go, like, we have access to so much brilliance and genius that we don't have any excuses to not, you know, have those kinds of positive messaging and advice. We all have access to it. There are so many free resources. It's just like once you know, even the most hard to reach or most expensive thought leaders who, you know, you could probably never hire, they still have free things out there, whether it's a book, a podcast, or whatever, just like, you know, what you guys are doing here. People might not have access to you, but they certainly can get a lot from just listening to these, right? So I just want to remind people that if they think that they don't have, you know, that access or they don't know those people, I would push you on that and say that you do.
Yeah, well, see, they have access to me because I'm a kind, loving, warm spirit. Matt is cold as ice and is shut away, agoraphobe, that will not take on new friends. I just can't take on anymore. So, guys, I love you. I'm here for you. Matt. Matt's playing a fiddle for all of you guys listening.
It's the world's smallest violin.
Oh, the love. Oh,
it's so funny because I love it when somebody comes into my life through the show. It's hilarious when they get on the phone. They're like, man, I really appreciate your time. Like, I so appreciate that you took the time to talk. I'm like, stop believing Greg. That's all I have to say about that. Like, I'm not an agoraphobe. I'm not a mean person. I get that business, but yeah, it's funny because Greg has created such an expectation on the show, but it's great. It works out because people really honor my time.
Yeah. There's one piece that I think I have to add to sort of this conversation around support system and, you know, all of that. which is, and we're talking about how to like ask the hard questions. I really think that a big part of how I add value to my clients is by giving them tough feedback, you know, asking them the tough questions and then giving them tough feedback. Yeah. Because that's the other thing is once you're a leader or once you're successful or once you're, you know, at some point in your professional life, people stop telling you the truth. And that's often where I find that my clients just love the value, you know, the conversations that I have with them, because I don't need you to like me. I'm here to support you to get from point A to point B. And if that means telling you something that maybe everyone's thinking that no one's telling you, or telling you something that nobody's really kind of noticed, but I just do because I've worked with a ton of people and can see those things, I will give that tough feedback. And it, you know, it doesn't always feel good, but I'll always say, hey, like, this is hard for me to say, but I need to tell you this, or I know this is important to you and you're just like really screwing this up right now. Whatever that is, I will be the person that tells them that, because that's, I think, an important piece. And so I encourage people to have people in their life that do that for them. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember when I first came to Silicon Valley, I was enamored by the tech world and I decided to start my own coaching app. I was like, I'm going to, you know, so I basically started to be like a tech startup founder. And I was speaking to all these people telling them about my app. And I guess because I'm passionate about things and I know the space really well, people were really getting excited about it. And I had VCs that were interested. And then I came across this one advisor and he basically just ripped it apart. Like just said, you don't understand technology. You have no idea. You haven't thought about this, you know, from this angle. And all you do is you go and you speak to people. And as soon as they validate, you're just going for validation. As soon as they validate your idea, or, you know, they're like, oh, yeah, it's a great idea, you stop the conversation and walk away feeling good about yourself. But you're not getting the real feedback. You're not having the conversation long enough that they can poke holes in your idea and actually give you some honest, you know, or really good feedback so that you can make your product better or your business better. And I was like, oh, my gosh. And
when did you run into Chris Lockhead?
Yeah, really.
He was right. You know, I thought, wow. I literally share the idea to the point that they get excited about it. And then I'm like, great. And then I walk away, you know, and so I wasn't really getting any information. I was speaking to all these brilliant people who knew a ton more about me that could have added a lot more value, but I just wasn't even looking for that feedback. I just wanted the validation. And then this particular advisor, I mean, I kid you not, after 9 or 10 months of working on what I was working on, this advisor asked me those tough questions. I went home and they did some deep reflection. And within 12 months, I decided to stop working on that completely.
Yeah.
Wow. And that's like, that you probably a lot of money and a lot of time and a lot of heartache as well. Mm-hmm. You know, pardon me? A real look.
Say that again, Greg.
It probably saved you a lot of time, energy, and money and heartache.
Yes.
You know, to go out there and potentially, you know, loss of VC money and everything else because you didn't take one single second to really stop and really go deep on that thought pattern. And you know what, if your wife says, do I look fat in these pants, lie your ass off. Okay. but if you, you know, that's not when you give the hard truth. Okay. You can still keep that in a certain spectrum in life. But you know, one of the things I love to do on the McDaniel Challenge is that when people say, well, I'm doing this, this, and this, I'm like, no, you're not, you're doing this, this, and this. They're like, no, I'm not. I'm like, well, yes, you are. Because us as third parties, and I'm not a full-time coach by any means, way, shape, or form, but I mean, I think sometimes as being a coach or something like that, you come into a situation with a fresh set of eyes and no emotional attachment. Therefore, you can point things out and call people on their bullshit because you're like, no, you're not really doing what you think you're doing here. You're over here, but you think you're over here.
Yeah.
And that when you say that to people and you can justify that, you know, that thought pattern, people are like, oh, and they really do appreciate the hard love, the, you know, the tough love and the hard talk.
All right. So let's finish out this way. So I would love to hear from both of you and Greg, kind of what is one of your favorite deep, like thought provoking questions that you like to ask either your clients or yourself on a regular basis?
Mm-hmm. Holly, I'm going to let you go first on that one. Since you're the coach, you know this stuff. I'm just going to glean off of you at the end. Oh, that's a good idea. I'll do this.
Well, you know, this one's come up earlier in this conversation, but it's an important one. It's one I often ask myself is like, what's really important to you? Like, what's really important to you, Ahalya? What's, you know, or to my clients, like, what's really important to you? Or what's important about that to you? What's important about that to you? And then sometimes it's like, oh, that's not important at all. Why am I spending any time on that? Right? Or it's like, oh, this, and then, or it is really important. And then we get more deeply connected to what that is. And then now we have more energy to take some action or to deal with it or to build that relationship, to make that phone call, to, you know, do that thing that's out of our comfort zone. So like the, yeah, like the what's really important to you or what's important about that to you.
Yeah, I like that a lot because, I mean, a lot of people say things are important to them because they want to look good in front of the general public or their spouse or their friends. You know, I tell a lot of people on the dream boards, everyone's putting up the Ferraris, Bentleys, the big houses, the hot chicks, whatever, hot dudes, whatever you're into. You know, and I said, is this truly what you really want? And they said, well, not really. I don't really want all this stuff. I'm okay, then why the fuck are you putting up there? Well, because it's a dream board. I'm supposed to put all the flashy things up there. I'm like, no, you're not, dude. If you want to open a freaking ice cream shop in Guatemala, and go open an ice cream shop in Guatemala, because it doesn't have to compete against my goals, my dreams. They're your goals, your dreams. They have to be authentic to you. If that list isn't authentic to you, then it is completely impotent. It will do nothing for your life because you don't truly want to achieve it. One of the things that I ask myself is, you know, did I become better? Did I become a better version of me from when I woke up to when I go to sleep? It can be one quote of a book. It can be helping someone do something. It can be anything. But am I a better version of who I am when I go to sleep? Or did I slide backwards or make no progress at all? And when I slide backwards or do nothing at all, it is a loss of a day. And so I try to, you know, with the journaling, you know, in this journal here, I'm able to track it, look at it. You know, it's, they ask me what my goals and my wins are for the day. They ask also, what did I fail at today? And you have to suck it up and write it down so you don't do it again. There's little check marks of all these different areas, what you did and what you didn't do throughout the week. I epically sucked on Wednesday and Thursday as a human because I was about ready to burn out. And I just laid on my couch and watched Netflix. And I did calls from my couch, like with a speakerphone on my chest. That was my work day. It was awesome. But it didn't get me to where I wanted to go. So I know I need to double it down this coming week. So who are you and how did you become better between when you woke up and you went to sleep? And did you help anyone? That's my goals. That's how I gauge it. So Matt, I'm throwing it back to you. Same question to you.
So the one that I'm working on with Pasquale, my friend and kind of mentor, is what's my victory for the day? It's not what's the mission, not the one thing, what's the whatever. It's what is the victory that I am committed to today in the sense that I am willing to expend all of my effort in a burst of activity and expend all of my strength and everything I have to hit that one thing that day. It's very difficult to come up with that one thing every day. Cause usually, I mean, if you're a salaried employee, it might be difficult for you to come up with one thing, but if you're an entrepreneur, it's 15 things. Like it feels like there's like 15 things that if I don't get any of those 15 done, I'm not going to be happy with today. And it's very difficult to step outside of that and say, no, like what out of those 15 things that I feel like need to get done today. What's the one thing that if I achieve that, I can celebrate success? And this brings us full circle to what we started off with. What's the one thing that if I achieve that today, that it's worth expending all my effort? Because if I hit that, I'll be able to consider today a success on the way to my bigger mission.
Way to go deep on that shit.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. All right, so let's go super shallow. Ahalia, how do people reach out to you and connect with you and contact you?
So the best way is definitely look for me on LinkedIn and add me on LinkedIn. So it's Coach Ahalia. That's the way to find me on LinkedIn. I believe the website, if they wanted a website, it would be influencewithbrilliance.com, sort of updating everything as we speak here. But influencewithbrilliance.com is the place that they could go. But LinkedIn would be a great way for people if they actually wanted to reach out to me, you know, send me a message.
Perfect. All right. And then for us, I'll briefly mention that you should follow us. Do not friend us on Facebook. Greg cannot accept friends. I do not typically accept friends unless we've actually had a phone conversation. And then I will accept your friendship on Facebook. So just
unless you're a three-legged midget, then Matt will accept your friendship if you're a three-legged midget.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, when Peter Dinklage grows an extra appendage, then I'll accept his Facebook friend request. All right. So Greg, you want to briefly mention Get Now Business?
Yeah, guys, I sorry I didn't mention it earlier. This show is sponsored by Getting Out Business. It is the live class that Matt and I are putting on. We are near capacity for the August run. We're going to show you guys how to get business now within 90 days. Start closing escrows within 90 days. No cold calls, no door knocking. With a budget of $500 or less on a monthly budget, we're going to show you how to, you know, you can partner up with networking companies called, you know, Rockstar Connect. We're going to show you how to use LinkedIn. Well, us. Matt will show you how to use LinkedIn incredibly effectively. We're going to walk you through a myriad of different things that are going to, you guys just don't know what you're not looking for. So it's sitting right in front of your faces. You just don't know that it's sitting there. And we're going to show you how to take those blinders off, see what, how you can get business today without cold calling, without door knocking. And damn it, it's a lot of fun. So we hang out on Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m., guys. We record them. You have access to that class, all the past classes, all the future classes. And we have a money-back guarantee. Matt, tell them about the money-back guarantee.
Oh, the guarantee is we want you to succeed so badly that if you do not feel like you can with this course, not only will we can just give you your money back, but that's not fun enough. We want to go buy you another course, buy another coach or a trainer for the same amount. And plus, we'll give you access to our other course, Rockstar Prospecting. So it's literally double your money back guarantee. And we'll get you into the right course that's a good fit for you. So that's the guarantee. And speaking of, Greg, a quick example of LinkedIn success, and this is just a big win for this week, so I want to share it. So I reached out to on LinkedIn. I found her on LinkedIn because we're connected through two people that I've interviewed in the past. So Andrea Wallace, the co-author of Go for No, is coming on the show. We're working out the logistics, but I reached out to her on LinkedIn, and we're having a conversation next week. She's coming on the show. She's psyched. She's already listened to one of our episodes, loves the format. She's coming on the show here in the next 5 weeks. So, guys, you have that to look forward to. So the co-author of Go for No, which we talk about all the time on the show, is coming on the show.
That is epic shit, dude. Business boner status. I mean, that's just good stuff right there. I mean, she – that book – has revolutionized my prospecting, guys, and we get to get her on because of Matt. All praise hail Matt Johnson.
Well, yeah. Thank you to Tactical Prospecting on LinkedIn. But anyway, that's an example of one of the things that you'll learn in getting out business. So let's wrap things up.
Yes.
Make sure to follow and connect with all of us. Make sure to connect with all of us on LinkedIn. As Ahalia said, that's one of the best ways to reach out to her. Make sure to do that right this second. Do not forget. Go find her and connect with her right now. Ahalia, thanks so much for being on the show. We really appreciate it. Stick around. We will turn off the recording, the Facebook Live, and everybody that's watching, we really, really appreciate not only you joining us for the live broadcast, but commenting and interacting with us and with each other. Make sure to connect with each other online and off outside of this. Let each other know in the comments where you guys are at so that you can keep each other in mind for referrals and connect with each other to grow the community and make sure that you're becoming rock star agents in your market. So with that said, Greg, take us away.
Yeah, you guys can go follow Ahalia. Her street ghetto name is Aoli, but she goes by Aoli only on the streets. But Ahalia, you're amazing. Thank you for your time. For all the rest of you guys, peace out, ninjas. We gone.